praise him for his majestic glory, the glory of his name. Come before him clothed in sacred garments. Thank you. Good morning, family and friends of Russell. We welcome you to Russell Temple today. Today, the best CME church in Alexandria, Virginia. Today, we're observing a social justice and human concerns ministry. The members will be participating in the order of worship today. We hope that you will enjoy. Thank you. Now we will have the hymn of praise by the Little Buds Chorus, Kumbaya, the invocation by Brother Odell Sherman, and then the scripture by Sister Lillian Harris.
Today, our hymn of praise is Kumbaya. You know the words, come unto me along with me.
Good morning, Russell Temple family. Before I give the invitation, I just wanted to say what a great job the Little Buds did. And also you saw the new addition. I want to say as a proud uncle of Evan Riley, the newest member of Russell Temple's Little Buds. At this time, we can all bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father God, we come to you this morning just giving you thanks, Father God. Thanking you, Father God, for another glorious day, Father God. We come to you, Father God, with bowed heads, humble hearts, Father God. Thank you for your grace and your mercy, Father God. Father God, as the Black History Month concludes, Father God, we enter now into the Lenten season, Father God. Thanking you, Father God, for your son, Father God, that who died for our sins, Father God. Father God, we'd like to thank you for this branch of Zion, Father God, and our shepherd and first lady, Pastor and First Lady Agee, Father God. Father God, we'd like to for you to just be with us this morning as our shepherd delivers the message, Father God. Be with all of the participants who are on this worship service, Father God. We'd like to thank you, Father God, for everyone in attendance of this worship service, and pray for those, Father God, who are unable to make it, Father God. We'd like to pray for the sick and the shut-in, Father God. We'd like to pray for those who are on a bed of affliction, as well as those who are going through bereavement, Father God. Now, Father God, we ask that the Holy Spirit be ushered into this fellowship, Father God. In your precious Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Good morning. I will be reading Luke 4, verses 16 through 21. He went to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." God's word for God's people.
All right. Thank you, Little Buzz, for bringing us into the church with that song, Kumbaya. Thank you, Brother Odell Sherman, for your invocation, and Sister Lillian Harris for your scripture. We will now have the litany by Sisters Tiffany Carey and Jonna Hardy, followed by the Equality and Social Justice Litany by Sister Vanessa Green.
Good morning. Oh God, we are reminded today of your infinite love for all people,
all races,
all colors,
all political affiliations,
all religious persuasions,
all social classes,
all economic statuses,
all nations.
We confess our tendency to think that we are the best, our perspective the most righteous.
Forgive us of our arrogance, O God.
We confess our tendency to judge others and to condemn those we find unworthy.
Forgive us of our impertinence, O God.
We see others with criticism.
You see us all with love-filled eyes.
We see only in part.
You see the world with infinite wisdom.
We see the external.
You see the heart.
Mold us to your way.
Form us to your heart.
Shape us with love.
Make us new with grace.
Our way is not of violence and empire, but in the power and beauty of the cross.
Our faith is not in politics, but in the transforming love of Christ.
May we work diligently to help meet the needs of those you love, both physical and spiritual.
May our eyes be open to the value and worth of each person we meet.
May your kingdom come, your will be done.
On earth as it is in heaven, amen.
Good morning, everyone, and praise the Lord. I am actually going to be giving the history of the Social Justice and Human Concerns Ministry here at Russell Temple. Believe it or not, the ministry is embarking on its 20th year of existence. The Social Justice and Human Concerns Ministry, formerly known as the Social Concerns and Committee was formed in 2003 under the pastorate of Reverend Charles H. Roman. Reverend Roman asked for a volunteer or volunteers to head up the committee, and sisters Vanessa K. Green and Carlene Jones answered the call. The committee's mission during the early years was to inform and keep the congregation abreast of current trends in the health arena, as well as civic concerns. Accomplishments of the committee in its first year included the implementation of a safety assessment of the church. We conducted the first ever recorded fire drill during morning worship service, ensuring the safe exit, of congregants from the building and establishing a safe room for members who were unable to exit the building safely and in a timely manner. The fire drill event was featured in an article in an edition of the Christian Index. Additional highlights included the initiation of a health and information fair, which evolved into an annual event. The goal of the fair was to provide information, health screenings, wellness, and nutrition seminars. We had the pleasure of having renowned nutritionist and author Dr. Rovinia, Dr. Roe Brock as our guest presenter, as well as a host of experts in the medical and financial arenas. We were grateful and appreciative to receive a grant from one of our city council members to assist in financing the sponsorship of the fair. Additionally, all presenters gave of their time and expertise without requiring a stipend. This tradition continues in subsequent years as well. The committee's focus has also included civic involvement, providing voter education and registration. In 2008, the committee joined with the newly formed Northern Virginia Coalition, a grassroots initiative organized and convened through the efforts of the Northern Virginia Urban League. The coalition's membership includes African American houses of worship and fraternal and social and sorority organizations. The primary focus was empowerment of African Americans during the historical 2008 presidential election. There was such a wonderful momentum of activities during this campaign, capped off with an old-fashioned voter rally held where attendance exceeded 500 persons. We continued our involvement with the coalition, and we were very proud to recognize their efforts as an award recipient of the Social Justice and Human Concerns Award in 2014. Under the pastorate of Reverend Gregory King, the committee became known as the Social Justice and Human Concerns Ministry. Through Reverend King's leadership, we joined with Vessels, the African American Ministers Leadership Council, whose mission is to empower African American congregations with voter education and registration information and events. Our chairwoman had the opportunity to be involved in a conference call of said members with President-elect Barack Obama to brainstorm, strategize, and ensure that African Americans were registered and armed with the appropriate voter information. In 2014, the Social Justice and Human Concerns Ministry presented awards on its annual day observance to the community, leaders, and organizations that exemplify excellence in providing outreach to the community. Recipients of the awards have included the Northern Virginia Coalition and Audrey Davis, Alexandria Black History Museum Director. In 2015, the ministry developed and awarded its first Alberta Mitchell Gray Award in honor and memory of the late Sister Alberta Gray, who was a dedicated community and church advocate, as well as a dedicated member of the Social Justice and Human Concerns Ministries. The Untouchables, a male mentoring group that she worked with for many years, were the first recipients of the award. The ministry took a hiatus in 2016, and in the fall of 2017, regrouped and presented a mini health forum. Under the pastorate of Reverend Dr. Michelle F. Parker, the ministry revived and was back on track, keeping the congregation abreast of current political and civic issues. The education and The ministry has provided several churchwide and community forums on topics such as voter education and registration, racism in a two-part series, the effect of the pandemic on mental health, financial scams, human trafficking, caregiving, and dementia. The forums were very well attended and the speakers presented excellent as well as pertinent information of the aforementioned topics. In the summer of 2018, the ministry participated in the CME Superhero Initiative, acknowledging superheroes within our community and educating our congregation on the characteristics of a community superhero. During the church school hour, we were elated to recognize two of Russell's disciples, Sister Bernice Golden and Sister Louise Hardy, as community superheroes for their work with the Stork's Nest and the Ruby Tucker Learning Center, respectively. We culminated the superhero series by having Alexandria's hometown hero, Mrs. Rosa Bird, to speak with the congregation on the characteristics of a superhero. We are very thankful for the current unsung heroes of the ministry who exhibit through their hard work and presence their dedication to the ministry. Past members of the ministry have included the late Alberta Gray, Robin Green Schofield, Demean Payne, James Bowmoultrie, Louis Golden II, Kimberly Carter, and Ayanna Palmore. Our current membership is as follows, and when I mention your name, would you please raise your hands? Vanessa Green, who is the current chair. Sister Tiffany Carey is the vice chair. Sister Harriet Anderson is our secretary. Sister Lillian Harris is our chaplain. And our newest member, Sister Jonna Hardy. Brother Odell Sherman, our lone male in the ministry currently. He's our superhero. And Sister Wanda Thurman Wynn. And we also have Sister Samaya Daniels Johnson, who's away at school, but she participates whenever we have one of our forums. While the ministry has accomplished many strides, the work is never ending. We are grateful to God for what we've been able to accomplish and pray his strength that there will be willing workers to put hands to the plow and continue to fulfill the mission of the ministry. Thank you so much.
Okay, everyone. Now we will be favored with a selection from the Little Buds, Jesus Wants Me for a Sunbeam. The Black History Moments is next, and then followed by that will be the offering by Brother George Hardy.
Jesus wants me for a sunbeam. Good morning. My name is Avery Arrington, and my Black History presentation is going to be on Oprah Winfrey. Now, who is Oprah Winfrey? We know Oprah Winfrey to be a talk show host, an actress, a producer, and a philanthropist. Some of Oprah Winfrey's work being The Oprah Winfrey Show, Color Purple, Princess and the Frog, Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, and Selma, and that's just to name a few. And if you don't know what a philanthropist is, a philanthropist is someone who promotes welfare and gives generous amounts of money to good causes and charity of their choice. But just like the rest of us, there is a background to our success and a story to be told. Oprah Winfrey's story begins January 29, 1954. She was born in Mississippi and raised by her grandmother on a farm. Oprah Winfrey would play act on the farm, so she's always felt and knew that she wanted to pursue a career in the arts. She would use the farm animals as an audience to practice. Oprah Winfrey was very smart. At the age of 2, Oprah Winfrey would begin to learn to read. She would express to her teachers that she did not belong in kindergarten, that she belonged in the first grade. And opposed to sending her to first grade, they sent her to the third grade. Oprah Winfrey was then sent to her mother at the age of 6 in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. There she endured traumatizing events, and she just stayed in an area where you wouldn't want anyone or any child to grow and have a life in. Luckily, she was sent with her father in Nashville, where she began her passion to want to speak for a living. There she began writing speeches and performing speeches. At one point in time, Oprah Winfrey would win $500 or receive $500 for one of her speeches. Unfortunately, Oprah Winfrey was sent back to her mother. There she would go back to horrible living conditions and would endure sexual abuse from men that lived in her house and from men that her and her family trusted. But again, Oprah Winfrey would go back to living with her father due to her bad behavior with living with her mother in Milwaukee. Now, Oprah's impact. Oprah Winfrey is a cheerful giver, as we know. It is said that Oprah Winfrey this year in total has donated $72 million to organizations and charities of her choice. Oprah Winfrey donates to charter schools and programs that support African-American students. Oprah Winfrey has a leadership academy in South Africa. Oprah Winfrey is a role model. She's the first Black woman to own her first production company, the Oprah Winfrey Network. Oprah Winfrey, as we know, is an award-winning woman. But one award that stood out to me the most was the Presidential Medal of Freedom, who she was presented to by President Barack Obama in the year of 2013. Now, in conclusion, I just wanted to say that Oprah Winfrey is personally one of my biggest role models, and she has taught me so much. She's taught me to keep going and that success comes with hardship and with trials. But at the end of every tunnel, there is a bright light, but you just have to keep going and keep pushing and keep pressing on and not to depend on what you've been through and what you're going through and what's to come on. You not to depend on it as a hindrance, as a reason to stop, to keep going and to want to keep going. She's taught me to stay in school and base my career off of having an education. Now, the system that we live in, they look at us funny because of the way we look, because of what our names are, and because where we come from. But having an education changes everything. Does it change the way they look at us? No. But it is a push for us. It is a reason why we keep going and wanting to have these big jobs and wanting to succeed big. There's always an importance to having an education and to wanting to strengthen our mentality. But it starts with believing that you can do it and that whatever you're going through is not a reason to stop. So I thank you for allowing me to present who my personal role model is this morning to you all. And I hope that you've learned something from this presentation. But if you haven't learned anything at all, I personally want to encourage you to just keep going and not to believe what naysayers may say about you because of the way you look. Hold your head up and keep going. Allow God to order your steps. Allow him to hold your hand. Give whatever you're going through to him. Meet him halfway, though, when you are asking for blessings. And continue to keep going, because there's always success in after whatever you're going through. Believe that it's going to pass. Thank you.
Father God, it's in the name of Jesus we come, giving you thanks for another day. We thank you, Lord, for health and strength as you give and for being on the right mind this morning, a mind to give. Heavenly Father, as you have blessed us, we want to bless this church and others as they come along. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Good morning to you. And for those that are paying on the 30K or whatever, note it on your check. Whatever you're giving on, kids, is, adults is $400, youth $50. Now you have three ways you can give, four ways you can give. Electronic giving, give a PayPal and Cash App. Or you can mail it in at the church, 507 North Alford Street, 22314. Or you can drop it off at the church, the same address. Or if you like, you can contact the steward, and they will so gladly come by and pick it up. Thank you, and may God continue to bless each and every one of you. All things come.
We will now have the ministry of music by the I-Team, followed by finally, the anointed word by our awesome pastor, Reverend Kevin Agee. Thank you.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Was that not powerful? Amen. And how appropriate as we conclude the observance of African-American History Month, and we have an African-American History Month presentation following our morning worship. Not only did we have one of those old songs, but from the Fisk Jubilee Singers, amen, the Fisk University, one of our outstanding historically Black colleges and universities. To God be the glory, amazing tech team. Y'all did it, amen. Y'all found the Fisk Jubilee Singers, amen. Love that picture from the 1870s, amen, from Reconstruction with the Fisk University Jubilee Singers. To God be the glory for the awesome things that God has done. Can we give God some praise for his worship experience on this morning? What a beautiful day the Lord has made. Can we give God some praise for 20 years of the Social Justice and Human Concerns, the Commission on Social Justice and Human Concerns Ministry? Amen. To God be the glory. Our worship leader, Sister Harriet Anderson, can we give God some praise? Amen. Can we give God some praise for the leader, the chair of our commission, Sister Vanessa Green? Amen. What a wonderful history that was shared for all the members of the commission participating and leading our worship on today. Can we give God some praise for Sister Avery Arrington? What an outstanding presentation. Amen. On Oprah Winfrey. Amen. 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 What a beautiful way to cap off this month. This entire month has been awesome. Amen. Brother Blair Carey started us out. Amen. Brother Austin Adams followed up. Amen. Brother Dylan Sherman came last week with power and passion, and Sister Avery Arrington. This was just awesome. Amen. This is a good way to go to the summit. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It just shows you, you know, what God will allow people to overcome. Amen. We give God thanks and we give God praise for the great history and legacy of our people. We give God thanks and praise for another blessed worship experience. To God be the glory for another opportunity to worship him in spirit and in truth. You heard our scripture for this morning. Sister Lillian Harris read our scripture from the fourth chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 4, verses 16 through 21. I'd like to call your attention to verses 18 and 19. Verses 18 and 19. The New Revised Standard Version is fairly close to the way that the New International Version reads, but I'll read verses 18 and 19 from the New Revised Standard Version. Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, the New Revised Standard Version. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Beloved, as we gather together on another blessed Lord's Day, as we gather together, as we observe our 20th anniversary of the Commission on Social Justice and Human Concerns of the Russell Temple Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, as we celebrate the great history of the power of our African-American brothers and sisters to be able to overcome various forms of adversity and oppression, I want you to reflect, pray, and meditate with me on the thought for today: anointed for action. Anointed for action. Let us pray. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Now may the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. My beloved, this is a passage that I'm often drawn to. And as we look at this passage, how apropos that it appears where it does in the sacred scripture. It was mentioned before Brother Odell gave the invocation. It was mentioned that we're in the Lenten season. I think Sister Anderson also mentioned this being the first Sunday of the Lenten season. And this passage actually appears in the Synoptic Gospel right after the story of Jesus being driven by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by Satan. So this story takes place near the beginning of Jesus' public ministry. As a matter of fact, the third chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke talks about the ministry of John the Baptist, who was the forerunner of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Then we transition into the beginning of the fourth chapter, where the first 13 verses are the story of Jesus' temptation in the wilderness. And how it's amazing at the end of that story, this is the particular version where it talks about after the devil had tried three times unsuccessfully to tempt Jesus, or basically he was unsuccessful at getting Jesus to give in to temptation, because we all know Jesus isn't going to give in to temptation. We may, but Jesus won't. But it's very interesting that this particular account, this particular gospel narrative of the temptation narrative, it says that when the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. I always focus on that until an opportune time, because it means that we all have to deal with the devil. And we all know about having to deal with the devil. Isn't that right? And particularly as we think about some of our history as a people who have been oppressed for more than 400 years, we got some experience on having to deal with the devil. Amen. We know about having to deal with the devil, but we transition from the story of the temptation narrative. We transition to the beginning of Jesus' ministry in Galilee. And of course, Galilee was the region where he grew up. He grew up in a little town called Nazareth. And, you know, we heard through Sister Avery's awesome presentation about Oprah Winfrey. We heard about some of the circumstances in which she grew up. and Nazareth was a rough place. You know, Nazareth was straight up hood. You know, and you know, as a matter of fact, folk even asked the question, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Amen. That's where our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ, grew up in his earthly childhood. He grew up in Nazareth. He grew up in a family of little economic means. He came up as one who knew what it was like to be amongst a people who was despised and rejected by the rest of the world. He knew what it was like to be an outcast. We tossed that around a little bit during the church school lesson this morning. Jesus knew what it was like to be an outcast. Isn't that right? Jesus knew what it was like to deal with sorrow. Jesus knew what it was like to deal with grief. Jesus knew what it was like to deal with abuse. Jesus knew what it was like to deal with oppression. He dealt with all of these things. And this talks about the beginning of his public ministry. And according to the word, his public ministry began when he was about 30 years of age. You know, even though he walked the face of the earth clothed in human flesh for 33 years, according to the tradition, from approximately 4 BC to 29 AD, his public ministry only lasted about 3 years and began when he was 30 years of age. And this story in the fourth chapter of the Gospel according to Luke depicts Jesus' ministry beginning in his home region of Galilee. The story is told beginning with that 16th verse about how he went into the synagogue where he was brought up on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. My. It was his custom. It was his custom to go to worship. It was his custom to go to synagogue. If I can put it in contemporary Christian terms, it was his custom to go to church. But he understood that you didn't just go to church. You had to be to church when worship service was over. Isn't that right? He didn't just go to church. We had to be to church when worship service is over. But on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue in his hometown of Nazareth where he was brought up. And he got up to read in the worship service. And they handed to him a scroll from the book of the prophet Isaiah. And he unrolled that scroll to Isaiah chapter 61. Verses 1 and 2. And what you find in Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19 is almost identical to what you find in Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 and 2. Jesus opened the scroll to the place where it said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free." You know, we love to use that word anointed quite a bit. You know, oftentimes when we love the way somebody preaches, we say they're anointed. When we love the way somebody teaches, we say they're anointed. When we love the way somebody sings the songs of Zion, we say that they're anointed. When we love the way someone does a liturgical dance, we say that the person is anointed. And yes, all of those things require their own anointing. But when we look at the word anointed, the Greek word that is translated anointed in the English language, and we also talk about anointing in terms of, you know, like David said in Psalm 23, he anointed my head with oil. And we also talk about anointing when we pray for the sick and lay hands on the sick and pray for their healing. We might anoint them with oil. Even last week, as we observed our Ash Wednesday service, those who did not have access to ashes, you were able to what? Anoint yourself with oil or even anoint yourself with water. You know, we even read the story in the Gospels about, you know, some scholars say it was Mary Magdalene, but the women with the alabaster box of expensive ointment who anointed Jesus' feet and then wiped the feet with her hair. So we think about anointing in those terms. And we think about anointing in terms of, you know, of exercising certain functions within the service of worship. But the Greek word, which is translated anointed in this particular text, not only does it mean to rub oil on, but the Greek word anointed, it means consecrated. It means consecrated to an office or consecrated for religious service. Therefore, my beloved Jesus was consecrated, but he was not just consecrated to be a priest. He was not just consecrated to save our souls. He was consecrated to liberate the oppressed. He was consecrated to transform culture. He was anointed to transform society. He was anointed to do some awesome and some powerful things. Jesus quoted those words, those same words that Isaiah quoted some 600 or so years before. And you have to understand that it is really powerful that Jesus opened that scroll to Isaiah chapter 61, because Isaiah chapter 61 is a part of the book of the prophecy of Isaiah, where God was offering reassurance to those particular Israelites and Judeans who had been captured by the Babylonians. The Lord was assuring people that the Babylonian exile or the Babylonian captivity was about to come to an end. So when we look at the language that Jesus uses in this particular passage, this is not just an illustration. This is not just a metaphor. Jesus intentionally read words that talked about a situation where the people of God were really poor. The people of God were really destitute. The people of God had their houses of worship destroyed. The people of God were literally homeless. Many of the people of God were in prison. The fact of the matter is, the people of God were really going through the situations and conditions that are described here in the gospel according to St. Luke. So this scripture really had practical application for the present day in the first century of the common era. And I submit to you this morning that it still has practical application in the 21st century. So when Jesus talks about, I've been anointed to proclaim, to bring good news to the poor. Notice where he starts out. The Lord has anointed me. The Spirit of the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. And yes, my beloved, the phrase bring good news is the Greek word actually means to announce good news. Some translators say that it means to preach good news. But the fact of the matter is, Jesus is not just talking about preaching a sermon. Jesus is not just talking about offering words of encouragement. When Jesus says the Spirit of the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, it means that we need to bring the poor a pathway out of poverty. It means that we need to have the audacity to speak truth to power so that our lawmakers who are making public policies will start making public policies that do not drive our people deeper into poverty. We need to have the audacity to speak truth to power so that lawmakers can make public policies that are going to get people out of poverty. We need to have the audacity to speak truth to power so that folk that make laws can implement public policies that'll eliminate hunger, that'll provide access to universal, affordable health care, and eliminate and eradicate all other conditions that drive folk into poverty and exacerbate their poverty. So the fact of the matter is, this is not just an anointing for proclamation. This is an anointing for action. Somebody ought to type anointing for action in the chat. If you're someplace where you can shout, you ought to just shout anointed for action. Not only that, beloved, but Jesus says that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to proclaim release to the captives. Isn't that right? The fact of the matter is, some folk were literally captive during the Babylonian captivity. And the fact of the matter is, there are a whole lot of folk who are captive now. As a matter of fact, some translations of this pericope also add on the words, the opening of the prisons to those who are bound. Amen. And I just want to tell you today, do we not need to open the prisons to some folk who are bound? Do we not need to put an end to mass incarceration? Do we not need to open the prison for folk who have been falsely arrested and falsely imprisoned? How many times have we read in recent months, in recent years, for that matter, even more recently, in recent days or recent weeks, how many times have we read about folk who have spent 25, 30, 35, 40 years or more in prison for crimes they did not commit, and they were finally exonerated by DNA evidence? And as a matter of fact, you still have some people sitting in prison who have been exonerated by the DNA evidence, but still have not been released from prison because you have a racist and an unjust so-called criminal justice system. Lord, have mercy. Did not the Spirit of the Lord anoint us to bring an end to those types of conditions? Did not the Spirit of the Lord anoint us to get some folk who are in prison out of prison? And for that matter, even when folk are incarcerated for crimes that they have rightly committed, the Spirit of the Lord anoints us to make sure that we ensure some restorative justice instead of 100% retributive justice.
Justice shouldn't be all about punishment. Justice should also be about restoration. Justice should also be about rehabilitation. Isn't that right? Justice should also be about preparing people to be able to reintegrate into society. Do we not believe that Jesus can change people's hearts and change people's minds? Yes, my brothers and my sisters, the Spirit of the Lord has anointed us to release the captives and to open the prisons for those who are bound. My, my, my. Yes, Jesus says the Spirit of the Lord has anointed him to proclaim the recovery of sight to the blind. And I would say not only those who may be physically blind, but also those who are socially, emotionally, and spiritually blind. The Lord calls us to a ministry of holistic healing. Isn't that right? The Spirit of the Lord has anointed us to let the oppressed go free. Isn't that right? To set at liberty. Some translations say to set at liberty those who are oppressed. Aren't you glad today that you serve a God who is the God of the oppressed? Aren't you so glad that we worship a Savior who is a liberator? But my brothers and my sisters in Christ Jesus, what's most powerful to me about this story is not only just what Jesus does, and make no mistake about it, what Jesus does is powerful enough all by itself. But as you come near the end of this story, it talks about how Jesus rolled up the scroll of the book of the prophet Isaiah and gave it back to the synagogue attendant. And Jesus sat down. And as Jesus got ready to teach the way he usually did in the synagogue, the text says that all the eyes in the synagogue were fixed on him. For me, what's most apropos for us today as we talk about anointed for action is verse number 21. In verse 21, the Bible says, then Jesus began to say to them, today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. So it's not just about reading the scripture. It's not just about receiving the scripture. It's not just about hearing the scripture. It's not just about remembering and retaining the scripture, but it's all about putting the scripture in action. The Spirit of the Lord has anointed Jesus for action. But check this out. Not only has the Spirit of the Lord anointed Jesus for action, but I submit to you this morning that the Spirit of the Lord has also anointed us for action. He has anointed his disciples for action. He has anointed the believers for action. Isn't that right? In the 14th chapter of the gospel, according to St. John, chapter 14 and verse 12, Jesus says, very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do. And in fact, will do greater works than these because I'm going to the Father. Is that not powerful, my brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus? The Lord anoints us to do the same things that Jesus does. The Lord anoints us to put our faith in action the same way he anointed Jesus to put his faith in action. And make no mistake about it, when Jesus was walking the face of the earth in human flesh, practicing his public ministry, he indeed put things in action. Isn't that right? I told you that the chapter preceding chapter 4 talked about the ministry of John the Baptist. Well, early in John the Baptist, a public ministry, while he himself was in prison, a couple of John the Baptist followers had visited him. And apparently they had told him about all of the awesome wonders that Jesus was doing. And when John the Baptist heard about these things, he told his followers to go back and ask Jesus, are you the one who is to come, or should we wait from another? And Jesus told the followers of John, he said, go back and tell John what you see and what you hear. The lame walk, the blind receive their sight, the deaf hear, the lepers are cleansed, the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. Yes, my brothers and my sisters, Jesus is the embodiment of the anointing in action. But just as Jesus is the embodiment of the anointing in action, Jesus wants us to also be the embodiment of the anointing in action. That's why Jesus said to his disciples, very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these because I'm going to the Father. We want us we want about the power of the Holy Spirit. Let the Spirit of the Lord use us to do the things that Jesus did. The old words of the hymn, "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing," by Charles Wesley. A couple of the stanzas of that great hymn say, "He breaks the power of canceled sin. He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood avail for me. Hear him, ye deaf. His praise, ye dumb. Your loosened tongues implore. Ye blind, behold your Savior come. And leap, ye lame, for joy." I don't know about y'all, my brothers and my sisters, but I'm so glad that the Spirit of the Lord has anointed us for action in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Somebody ought to say action. Hallelujah. Action. Anointed for action.
Amen. Hallelujah. There may be someone worshiping with us this morning who would like to invite Jesus, not only our Savior, but our Liberator, to be the Lord and the Savior of your life. If there is anyone worshiping with us today who would like to know the joy of the forgiveness of your sins, who would like to be 100% assured that your soul is saved, and when life on this side of glory as we know it comes to an end, that your soul will spend eternity in heaven with Jesus Christ our Lord sitting at the right hand of God the Father, it's real easy. Brother Jeff, is just that simple. Amen. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you will be saved. It's really just that simple, beloved. Sometimes my philosophy is people make stuff much more complicated than it needs to be. If you want to give your life to Christ today, or for that matter, if you're already a believer and you want to recommit, rededicate your life to Christ, we invite you to do so. Or if someone is worshiping who's looking for a church family, we'd love to have you at Russell Temple. Now, this time, I'm going to ask you to call or text me. Amen. I do have various accesses to social media. However, I'm going to let y'all know I'm doing a little fast from posting on social media for the Lent season, along with my food sacrifices. I'm doing a little social media sacrifice, too. Amen. So I prefer to call or to text. Amen. Because if you inbox me, I may not see it. Amen. My cell phone number is in the chat, 201-736-9107. I will respond. Amen. Whether I recognize the number or not, I'll respond. Amen. If you're not in the context, that's all right. I will respond. But please feel free to call me or text me. I'd love to receive you into the kingdom of God. I'd even love to receive you in the Russell Temple, CME Church. Whether it's one of the first or the third Sundays when we worship in person, or it's the second, fourth, or fifth Sunday when we're worshiping virtually. At all times, the doors of the church stand wide open on the hinges of welcome. We want to welcome you to the body of Christ. We want to welcome you to the kingdom of God. Is there one who will unite with the family of God today? Is there one who will unite with the kingdom of God? Is there one who will unite or reunite with the body of Christ? Is there one who will give his or her life to Christ on today? The doors of the church are wide open, my beloved. Will you come today? Hallelujah, praise God. Before we have our announcements and the concluding of our worship experience, we just want to go before the Lord our God for a word of prayer. And as we go before the Lord our God for the word of prayer, we especially want to lift up Sister Mary Hemphill, who's recovering from a successful surgical procedure on this past week, and for Brother James Anderson, who is recovering from a successful surgical procedure from the week before last, from the previous week. So we lift up all of our brothers and sisters facing health challenges. We also want to lift up our beloved Bishop James B. Walker and his family as he mourns the loss of his sister, who will be funeralized in just outside of Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, on this coming Saturday. We pray God's blessings for all of our brothers and sisters who've experienced loss and grief. Let us go before the Lord in prayer. O thou in whose presence my soul takes delight, on whom in affliction I call, my comfort by day, my song in the night, my hope, my salvation, my all. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and mercy. Thank you, Lord, for being our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Thank you, Lord, for being our liberator when we are oppressed. Thank you, Lord, for being our strength when we're weak. Thank you, O God, for loosing the bonds of injustice that have held us down and bound us. Thank you, Lord, for being our all in all and our everything. Thank you, Lord, for healing us in our affliction. Thank you, Lord, for comforting us in our sorrow. Thank you, Lord, for supplying our every need according to your riches and glory. Lord God, we pray that you would lay your hand of healing upon Sister Mary Hemphill. We pray that you would lay your hand of healing upon Brother James Anderson. We pray that you would lay your hand of healing upon all of our brothers and our sisters facing various health challenges. And oh Lord, our God, we pray your comfort, strength, and peace upon Bishop Walker and his siblings and his family and the loss of their sister. We pray your blessings upon his nieces and nephews and the loss of their mother. We pray, oh God, your blessings upon all of our brothers and our sisters who have experienced loss and grief. And Lord God, we lift up all of our brothers and sisters who are still oppressed. We lift up all of our brothers and our sisters who are still falsely imprisoned. We lift up all of our brothers and sisters who are unsheltered and homeless. We lift up all of our brothers and our sisters dealing with addiction and alcoholism. Lord God, we lift up all of our brothers and our sisters still fighting the pains of sexism, racism, misogyny, classism, Lord God, all forms of bigotry, prejudice, and ignorance. And oh Lord, our God, we just pray that you would help us to let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. Lord, we pray that you would make us instruments of your peace, instruments of your justice, instruments of your grace, instruments of your mercy, and instruments of your love. In the precious name of Jesus, our liberator and our savior, we pray. Amen.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure. Oh, glory,
glory, glory.
Oh,
the heavens, no man, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposition in us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, the spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walked through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we woman and man up. They say stay down, and we stand up. Shots, we on the ground, the camera panned up. King pointed to the mountaintop, and we ran up.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, now the war is not over, victory isn't won, but we'll fight on to the finish, and then when it's all done, we'll cry glory, oh glory, oh, oh.
Selma is now for every man, woman, and child. Even Jesus got his crown in front of a crowd. They march with the torch, we gon' run with it now. Never look back, we done gone hundreds of miles. From dark roads, heroes, to become a hero. Facing the League of Justice, his power was the people. Enemy is lethal, a king became regal. Saw the face of Jim Crow under a bald ego. No one can win a war individually. It take the wisdom of the elders and young people's energy. Welcome to the story we call victory. The coming of the Lord, my eyes have seen the glory.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, glory,
glory,
glory.
Amen. Hallelujah. I'm sorry. I was having some problems trying to unmute myself. Amen. To God be the glory. Very quickly before the doxology and the benediction, beloved. First, amazing tech team. Thank you so much. Awesome job as always. Again, we give God praise for our Commission on Social Justice and Human Concerns. What powerful worship experience on tomorrow. I mean, I felt today rather. Please stay tuned. Amen. Please stay on as our Board of Christian Education Formation will lead us in our Black History Month observance. They have an awesome presentation. I know you'll enjoy it. I know it'll bless your soul as well as enlighten your mind. So please stay on with us. And then a couple of hours after, at 3 o'clock Eastern time, please come back and join us for our 64th anniversary of the male chorus of the Russell Temple Christian Methodist Episcopal Church. During the Lenten season, my beloved, our focus for our Wednesday evening worship experiences during the Lenten season will be the practice of passionate worship. The practice of passionate worship. That's what we'll be focusing on during this Lenten season, each Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock. And I believe our first messenger is somebody who loves to worship. Amen. I heard that Sister Wanda Thurman Wynn was excited about being invited to kick us off. Amen. And we know she boldly proclaims the love of worship. And I think they chose the right one to start us off in the Lenten season, the practice of passion worship. Yes, there is power in passion worship, but the proper title is the practice of passionate worship, focused on the five practices of fruitful congregations. Last but not least, let me say thank you to our missionaries, our local president, Sister Louise Hardy and Sister Marie Manning, our missionaries who represented us as we presented the gift from the New York, Washington region, Women's Missionary Society to the Carpenter Shelter. And that was a powerful experience. I mean, we out of time, so I can't tell you what a powerful experience that was. I don't have time to go into it, but let's just say in less than a half hour in that facility, we learned so much about all the different dimensions that go into trying to help people, you know, recover from homelessness. Amen. So what a powerful ministry they have there. And the missionaries could not have selected a better organization to receive that gift. God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. Please stay tuned for our Black History Month celebration. To God be the glory for the awesome things that God has done. Amen. As we dismiss from our final morning worship service of African American History Month and the conclusion of our celebration of 20 years of ministry to the Commission on Social Justice and Human Concerns and transition to our African American History Program, what more appropriate prayer for our benediction than that last stanza of the words of the great hymn by James Weldon Johnson? God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who hast brought us thus far on the way, thou who hast by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever in the path we pray, lest our feet stray from the places, our God, where we met thee, lest our hearts, drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadow beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land. And the church said, amen.